Welcome, good afternoon everybody, and welcome to this session within the 36th edition of the Rimini meeting. The title is self-explanatory, Smart Cities, the Future of Towns and Cities. The aim of today's conference is that of focusing on the future of cities in the light. So here is a local councillor. So in the light of the important technological innovations and in the light of the evolution and the development of solutions that can also be used in cities, in town planning, and in services connected with the use of cities. And we will now focus on these issues with the aim to disseminate information. So I will now leave the floor to the important guests we've invited. We would like you to understand what we're talking about with the first contributions, and then we're going to have a look at an example of an entrepreneur who is developing a smart city in Brazil, so that you can have a practical, concrete example of what we are talking about. I will now introduce the guests, and then we will immediately start the debate and the conference. If there is some time left at the end, some speakers are ready and willing to accept questions. The first speaker I will leave the floor to is Mr. Marco Moretti. Today, the group CAO of an important company, A2A, the group CAO, means that he deals with issues related to technology, information technology within this company. Among the topics dealt with is there is a company which is called Smart Cities. I will now leave the floor to Marco, and then I will introduce the other speakers. Thank you very much, Sandro. I have some slides to show you, if you can please start with the slides, because I would like to give you some practical examples. I will go very rapidly. These are the. This is the turnover of A2A. We are located in towns. We are a multi-utility. I will not focus on the financial data of company profile. This is the slide I'm interested in. I would like to talk about cities. Why am I going to talk about cities? And what does the word city has to do with multi-utility? Multi-utility, heat heats a city. It lights a city with the electricity. It cleans a city with environmental services. We provide water, and we protect the cities with tele safety services. These are some figures in related to the towns and cities we are present in. You see Brescia, Milano, Bergamo, etc. I would like to talk to you about the city of the future, the services. I have just mentioned other typical services for a town, for a city. The future services will focus on the technological aspects. I will try not to be too technical. These are the key three key trends of information technology. The first one is well known to us all, internet and mobile and the digital technologies have had a devastating impact in our lives. We're going to talk about Internet of Things, namely the technology that is in yellow. It's the second important trend, which will move from 1 billion devices connected today to 30 billion devices connected within 4 years' time. So we're going to have traffic lights, bridges, household objects, other objects connected to the internet. And then the third trend I will not dwell with today, we've called it the dawn of the planet of machines. This is a trend for 2020-2022. It is very well much represented, represented in one of the stands, close to our own stand. You can have an idea of the impact that these smart machines will have in our lives. This is the most stupid object in a town, in a city, a dustbin. This is a bin in a city with a volume sensor, which tells us in real time whether the bin is full or not. This is a 1 minute video, and so I will show you the experience we've had in this respect. So this is how it works. There's a constant scanning of the filling level, an automatic sending of data, so the bin communicates the level of filling and tells us it's time to empty it. This is the way we work today, and we empty all the bins, the empty ones and the full ones. This is our current way of working. And at times, we touch two times bins that have already been emptied. What we want to achieve is to improve our pathway for the collection of waste so that we only touch the bins that are already full. In the 6 months of the Expo in Milan, these bins were located in the area of Città Studi in Milan. It was very interesting to see the hours in which these bins were full and those who were most used than the others. I would like to present you with this challenge. What's happening? The Internet of Things will speed up the process of electronics. Here we have physical data of cities. Because we had the volume sensors, we managed to create the smart bin. The sensors measure the speed, the temperature of flows, the noises, smells, heat, water level. So the physical elements are more and more. This is a first trend which will speed up the smart cities. And then the sensors will become smaller and smaller, therefore easily applicable to the objects. They are going to cost less and less. But above all, as you can see, the last important trend, an important topic in placing sensors in a city, in order for the city to become smart, is that the sensor remains in the city, it needs electricity. The modern sensors can work in a city with a battery with no electricity. They can work for 2 or 3 years. So sensors become more and more performing, they are smaller and smaller, they get cheaper and cheaper, and they are going to need very little electricity. These are the four key factors that will enable us to create smart cities with the implementation of 10,000, 20,000, 30,000 sensors that will monitor the everyday life. This is a smart city today. What did we do in the past? We provided the basic services of the smart city with a broadband, some activities, a smart city which is digital, with cameras for safety, a smart city in which you have a Wi-Fi network for the tourists. These are basic services available in all cities, and we added the smart parking lots and what you will see in the next slide. This is another 1 minute video, giving you the idea of what happens to a city if you place more sensors. Each icon represents a symbol of a sensor.
Thank you. diceva Bicocchi.
So as Mr. Bicocchi said earlier, we believe so much in the future of multi-utility, providing basic services today in cities and then providing evolved services in the future, that we created a specific company which will provide these specific digital services in the future. These are the future services. Think about what a sensor can do. A sensor can measure the smart health, so all that is related to house management of the elderly or of people who are ill, the possibility to have smart parking places, the possibility to control and monitor avalanches, floodings, acts of vandals. So you can use the sensors for many, many purposes. We have potentially endless uses for sensors, provided a city is ready to receive them. This is our stand at Pavilion A5. You can have a look at a 3-minute simulation. So you will wear an Oculus and you can have a tour, a virtual tour in the city of the future, equipped with these sensors. Here is another example of about 30 services that can be provided. A service for a smart city needs 4 key elements. Sensors, it needs the infrastructure linking the sensors, it needs collecting data, and it needs an application for the final service. Why did the smart cities not succeed in getting smart, really smart, up to now? Because these 4 elements are not always present. We are going to provide these 4 elements horizontally so as to speed up the provision of services, collection of data, and the network of sensors. If you want a smart cities service, you can focus on the 2 vertical components, sensors and the applications. This is an important element we want to add, which refers to our vision in completing this project for the smart cities. Another important element is that of open data, putting at the disposal of the local administrations a whole lot of information. We will have about 2 million information per minute in our smart cities in the future. Several kinds of information: when a citizen throws a waste, when a parking place has been left, when it is busy. We can have smart monitoring of the environment, the quality of the air. Smart mobility means making the traffic of a city smarter and lighter. This is smart parking. There are sensors on the stalls which give you information on the possibility to have a free parking, and we can reduce the parking time about 40%. This is a smart healthcare sensor with a smart building. This is a more classical kind of service. So we've been providing it for several years. It means making more efficient the service related to heating and other aspects related to the housing. This is smart lighting. This is the optimization of public lighting of a city. Not only replacing the lamps, the bulbs with the LED lamps, but also turning on the lights when they are needed. So being able to control the level of light. I will close my presentation before conclusions. The smart city is composed by these 4 fundamental elements. On the bottom part, we have an infrastructure reading the sensors. It is an infrastructure which needs to be open and possibly controlled by the public sector. That's the most strategic element. Then sensors, the elements that are connected, and they are related to the individual services. The 3rd key element are the data, so collecting data and managing, optimizing data. And then 4th, the final application towards local stakeholders or citizens. We work We're working in Lombardy, but we've been contacted by about 20 cities outside Lombardy to work with the local utilities. We are multi-utility, and we believe that we need to take on this responsibility to be the ones who implement and achieve the smart cities, because they are already present. This is why our model works outside the Lombardy region. We've also organized a lab that can be visited in our pavilion. We've placed about 20 sensors in the town of Brescia. They are recording a whole set of information that can be seen on the website. Conclusions, and then I will leave the floor to the other colleagues. The multi-utility at territorial level, so gas, electricity, basic services, is moving towards evolved, advanced services, the Internet of Things. It is an important value for territorial stakeholders and for local administrations, so we need the Internet for Things, which is emerging, an emerging technology. We're going to move from 1 billion devices to 30 billion devices in 4 years' time. 1 billion devices only in Italy. The sensors are getting smaller, cheaper, and they are becoming less and less energy consuming. These four elements will enable us to create the smart cities in the future. I now leave the floor to Sandro. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marco. Thank you, because I think that your contribution has helped us focus on the real topic of this meeting, of this session of the meeting, and to help us understand why we wanted to have a session on this topic. And I'd like to thank you also for the fact, because you've sticked to the timetable. You spoke for just 13 minutes out of the 15 allotted to your speech. Before leaving the floor to the next speaker, allow me to give you some information. There's data from the Smart City Observatory of the Italian Municipalities Association, according to which about 30% of people will live in urban areas by 2030. So this means that there's a commitment, first and foremost, a commitment on the part of the United Nations, according to which the transformation of cities into smart cities is one of the objectives belonging to the Millennium Development Goals. So this means that this topic is very topical. It can be reached, it is attainable, if you consider the fact that in just a few years, two-thirds of the world population will live in cities, as Marco mentioned. Councillor Parolini will speak last. He's going to talk about policy making. And I think that this is additional food for thought on his part. Now I'd like to leave the floor to another speaker to address the fact that we need the technology, the hardware, and then we need the software, we need the applications that do certain things by using all the information gathered. Carmelo Papa is the Managing Director and General Director of SGS Italy, will help us go into the details of the technology parts of the sensors. The floor to you. Thank you. Good afternoon. So technology works. I am the managing director of STMicroelectronics Italia, and we do the microchips. Without technology, the things we do wouldn't exist. So we're very happy of participating in this competition. Not only of smart cities, because microchips are everywhere. Wherever you have electricity and you have harvesting, you have these small bricks that have electronic devices work eventually. Many of the things I'm going to talk about will repeat what my colleague has just said. I'm going to focus in particular on technology, and my presentation is not going to be, so to say, ultimate and final, because many topics I will only touch upon, but I'm not going to go into the details. For example, I'm not going to focus on the issue of, for example, remote control, and that will also be a part of smart cities. So I'm just going to make you a series of examples, which does not intend to be ultimate in terms of content. Titles are in English, and our company works worldwide, so that's why the presentation and the examples are in English. And then, I mean, you have the slides in English, and I'm going to talk in Italian. So why smart cities? Over 60% of the population will reside in conurbations. And also elderly people will live in smart cities. So 65-year-olds and older will become twice as much. Will more than double from here to 2020. This poses a whole series of problems. As regards resources, resources are by definition not unlimited. So with technology we can save in terms of emissions in the atmosphere, CO2 emissions. So, and much depends on the orientation given by man to technology. Technology is only the result of the human brain to develop concepts and applications, but ultimately its use depends on human beings. So if nuclear energy, just to make you an example, can be good or bad, but technology in general is progress for man. My company is a multinational. And we are proud to say that most of the actuators, microcontrollers, and sensors that we produce for smart cities are produced in Italy, between Agrate, north of Italy, so near Milan, Catania, Sicily, Naples, Brindisi, Aosta, so in, as well as in lots of universities, centers, the Polytechnic, the Technical University of Turin, Milan, the National Research Center, and so on and so forth. So there are lots of centers in our cities that collaborate with us. We carry out short-term courses, they carry out long-term courses, and that's a very good example of the things that we can still do in Italy. So let us now focus on the examples I'd like to make. So smart city lighting. Each of these blocks that you see shows the technology we need. We need smart sensing, so smart sensors. We need processing abilities, so the abilities of microcontrollers, the ability to transmit and receive data, and energy management. So power consumption should be as low as possible, otherwise this won't bring any benefit at all. On the right, vertically, you see the possible uses in smart cities. First of all, any city will have the possibility of controlling the all the lamps, all the sources, the light sources they have in their cities, and then replace them if needed. It will be possible to install cameras anywhere for safety reasons. The color, color lighting, the color of the lighting can be changed for city beautification and also for energy saving. It will be possible, for example, to install sensors in certain quarters. And the next step can be seen in the bottom right-hand part of the slide. So monitoring, controlling traffic, to have rerouting, in other words, to redirect traffic towards streets and roads where traffic is less. Sensors will be of different type. They will apply this rerouting, and they will also carry out pollution monitoring. Sensors will make it possible to check the humidity level, the CO2 level. All these things will enable us to live in a better environment. Then smart homes. Just imagine a house that is independent, energy independent. You may have solar photovoltaic panels on the roof. They're rigid now, they can be flexible. They will become flexible in the city in the future. On the walls, we have photovoltaic panes. This is not so visible in small houses, but if you consider skyscrapers with very large walls, in these cases, you have photovoltaic panes converting the photons coming from the sun into energy, and they can be useful, for example, to maintain certain temperature levels inside the buildings. So we are already talking about the panels. Their efficiency will improve. We are already 20% efficiency in now, but we're making progress. They're becoming really competitive, even without subsidies. They're very competitive compared to the traditional energy sources or energy generation sources like oil or nuclear energy. And then the smart home will need a very important thing inside. One of the aspects that we sometimes not focus so often. Out of all the applications that you have, the appliances that you have in the house, for example, washing machines, TV, satellite TV, or any other utilities or appliances that you have in your house, when these devices don't work, they have that standby light, which means that they have a minimum consumption. If you multiply that standby light for the millions and millions of appliances in the world, we're talking about huge consumption levels. So in terawatt levels. And which are wasted for nothing. So these, we're now talking about the so-called zero power for the standby. This will enable us to save a lot of energy with the possibility not to build, for example, nuclear power plants, and that's a great benefit for mankind. Many other things can be done inside the house, for example, protection against robbers, ambient lighting, so the color of the lights, for example, you come home from your work and you want to have comfortable environment, and this can be set. For example, you can decide the color of the lights, maybe a warm color temperature in your living room, so that if you enter the room and your wife smiles, you can see it better. And the next step we're working on will be that of the so-called augmented reality inside. In other words, you enter a room and you may have, for example, a writing on the wall telling you that there's a given program you would like to see, which is about to start on TV, or you a writing, for example, telling you that there's no fridge in, that there's no cheese in the fridge, and asking you if you want him to order directly it from the internet or not. These are all things that are possible, and we're working on them. Talking about the smart meters, our company and my group in particular have always worked on smart meters. We're now working on the new generation of them. Compared to the past, for example, if you consider the classical Eno smart meter, they're also sponsors of the Rimini meeting, by the way. So in the past, a family would consume energy and would basically transmit, convey the data to Enel. Now there is a bi-directional communication. They can tell you what kind of consumption you are carrying out, if you can have better energy at a better price. And plus, the new meters will make it possible to enable a whole series of other services in the home. And that's the so-called the power line modem in the house through wires of the electricity wires. You can download certain files from the internet or videos from the internet in a simplified way and in low cost way, thereby using the power lines, the electricity lines. This will be the content of the meters we're going to install in the next 4 years. So this is another example. we installed about 38 million electronic meters in Italy, and we're going to about additional 30 million new ones over the next years. The important thing is that the first smart meter in the world was created in Italy. And these technologies were then sold to China, to the United States. So the utility companies are very much local. So it's difficult to enter, for example, the German market or the British one. We succeeded in entering the Brazilian market, the Russian market, China, the United States, France also to a lesser extent. So I'm just giving you three examples of three Italian companies. Enel is the first one. Then the smart meter for gas with MEMS sensors, capable of perceiving vibrations and capable of understanding whether a vibration is linked to the presence of gas in the tube or if it is linked to earthquake. And in this latter case, gas is discontinued. The gas provision is discontinued. And then we have smart street lighting provided by an Italian company that we collaborate with. Ariston, it's in the Marche region. With them, we're working on a generation of whole new things that will serve smart cities. They do remote control of boilers. So basically, they control whether boilers work or not. If they don't work, they send you the technician. And then Kundis, another example. That's for the control of temperature in ideal distribution of temperature in the houses, inside the homes. Smart garbage collection, that's another very interesting example. We were talking about this before. With a little bit of creativity, we are already working on this very interesting thing. And the next step here we can optimize the work of garbage collection trucks. So, for example, when you can ask for the truck to collect your garbage only when the bin is full, and this basically will help improve. And the next real step, and we're working on that, refers to sensors, robots in the house, directly collecting garbage and directly doing the separate waste separation. Actually, I would say that husbands will be very happy of this, because at the moment husbands are the ones that do separate waste collection. So some of these sensors understand what glass is, what actually other types of waste are. This will be the real advantage. This will really improve life in cities. Then smart driving. These are small steps that are part of the life of cities. We're working on this too. We're working in collaboration with a number of leading car manufacturers in the world. We are talking about self-braking cars, or self-accelerating cars if you set a certain temperature, or automatic parking. So the higher the segment of the car, the more these services are present. Next step in this case is autonomous driving. So we will reach a stage in which you will simply get into your car, sit and tell your car that the car has to drive you to a given road. You probably heard that some accidents have taken place in the United States. One of the fundamental reasons for this smart driving to work well is that all cars have to have the same sensors. If you have one car with a type of sensors and the other ones, 400 ones, don't have them, then you may have problems. It's a matter of legislation, technology, and implementation. Then smart parking and tolling. Let us assume I come to Rimini with my car and then give a voicemail to the city of Rimini telling them I'm coming to Rimini, my name's Carmelo Papa, I want a park. Let's assume I want to go to Piazza Duomo in Rimini and ask the municipality where the nearest park place to my final destination is, and I would also like to know what kind of rate I can pay. If you go to a parking place today, they already see you, 105 free parking lots. But what's missing is the connection between all parking lots and parking places in town. So we are talking about parking places which are there. And what's missing is the possibility of having information from the other side. Maybe knowing that you have a parking lot that costs a given rate if it is at a given distance, and maybe less to in another given distance. This is useful for the user and to utilities to reroute traffic. Another example might be museums and theaters. With augmented reality, we can do lots of things. First of all, one can reserve, let's say, a ticket for a theater show or to enter a museum. You simply tell what your needs are. Let's assume you want to go to a museum and you want to see all Picasso's works of art. You may have a direct answer on your glasses for augmented reality or on your phone. These glasses were launched by Google, but they will come back because they were not initially very successful. They were too heavy, but they will come back modified. So depending on what you've requested, you will receive certain information on the painter and all information that you normally do not find at the moment. Or, for example, you may have information on the theater show, on, let's say, the opera performance, the Giuseppe Verdi who wrote it. This information will be sent to you on your smartphone or on your glasses. You may have historical information on a given building, and so on. So some kind of a Wikipedia being brought directly to you. I'm almost to the end. A very important thing is safety, the safety of buildings. Buildings get worn over time, like any other things. So in Italy, we've been working on some infrastructures and bridges, for example. We've been applying sensors to measure the stability of those infrastructures. At the moment, we have MEMS sensors. So basically, sensors measuring linear acceleration or angular acceleration. And these are the sensors, which the same sensors which, for example, are in smartphones that orientate basically your picture if you move your smartphone. And the same thing can be done for a building. The next step is to apply chemical sensors in the buildings, registering the pH from basic to acid, telling you that, for example, the iron or the concrete structure starts degrading. This way, you can ultimately have a series of data which can be then further analyzed and helps you understand if the building is stable or has been subject to an earthquake. This will greatly, greatly improve the structure of cities. Of course, a number of things are needed for smart cities. Smart systems. Then we need broadband communication systems, because we have to send lots of data back and forth. So big data processing, so this new smart way of analyzing data, and smart renewable energy forms. These are things that are there. In Italy, we have them and we can do them. But not all the glitters is not gold. So the smart cities, which are connected through smartphones or remote sensors and so on, this is software. This is all software But hackers can, in a way, get in, and this is a risk. Another important risk is data. There's too much personal data which is sent in to the net, and so there's a risk for privacy. However, technology is neutral. We are called upon to control these things. And I'm done, I think. I would only like to say that we have everything to say. Actually, I'm finishing here. Thank you very much. Thank you, Carmelo Papa.
Before leaving the floor to Mr. Filipelli, sales and business development director of Microsoft Italy, but he's also the head of the IoT strategy of Microsoft. So he will voice as a representative of a very large corporation. Then we're going to have the contribution by Mr. Savio, the president of Planet Idea, a company working in Brazil. He's going to show us a video with a concrete example of a smart city close to Fortaleza in Brazil, with this smart idea. So I will leave the floor to the two speakers, because what Roberto will tell us is going to be the prelude of the video that we will watch afterwards. So we've understood that among the applications of the smart cities, one is that of the rethinking of the buildings, and not simply thinking about simple traditional services, the color of lights, for instance, or the provision of resources such as the cheese in our refrigerator. But we should also focus in terms of town planning, because we have a deficit of living capability. Bear in mind that by 2030, lots of people will displace and will go to live in cities. I am lucky enough to work in Italy, so with any company developing a digital solution in Italy. I would like to dwell on how these digital transformations have an impact in our everyday life. So we will talk about solutions and what we call apps. In order for what you saw to function, to work, we need a great collaboration on the part of many businesses. So no obstacles, no barriers should be implemented. This is why we are here today. I have no slides, but if you want, I have some demos to show you how Microsoft is open to collaborate. So the issue of opening is fundamental in this field. As Mr. Moretti already said, try and look, try and use a smartphone to look for the word Microsoft when you look for apps. Microsoft has been developing solutions on any kind of smartphone, because this is fundamental, because when we have to use this kind of innovation, we shouldn't have no barriers. Whoever develops a solution to optimize a home, a building, or what you see every day in smart cities, as we will see in the smart cities of the future, no barriers of any kind should exist. So the opening up of the large corporations, multinational corporations, is a key pillar. This is just to show you that Microsoft is engaged in developing solutions for Apple and Android smartphones. We have various examples of active collaborations. If you remember the concept of clusters, the northeastern part of Italy was an example of the sharing economy. The key point was that whoever carries out technological development, well, these developments should be at the disposal of everybody. So if we summarize what we've seen in these slides, Well, ST brings in intelligence into existing objects or new objects, but along with them, we ensure that they dialogue, that they discuss, so to say, with the cloud. So you have smartphones representing a physical device you have in your hands. This may be a smartphone. We use it, or it may be a smart bin for garbage, or it may be a smart coffee machine, etc. These machines need to talk safely with the cloud systems. An example, in the everyday life, you have a smartphone, you can organize a video conference with Skype. The Skype service is something which is in the cloud, the ephemeral thing we cannot see, but which is fundamental. Imagine you are a manufacturing company which decides to invest to manufacture smart bins, and you're going to sell these bins all over the world. So the smart bin should be assembled, and it must remain smart no matter which country you install it, you place it. It must say whether it is full or not. If you have a smart bin, but you also have a service in Latin America which tells you whether the bin is full or empty. The clouds are systems to collect data, and they must be ubiquitous. So everywhere in the world, this is why multinational companies such as Microsoft create these cloud platforms that can host the smart solutions of whoever develops something. This is why I called it digital solution. The bin, the smart bin, is a digital solution made of something physical, sensors, safe connectivity, and services providing the managing company the correct information on the status of the bin, no matter the country where it is located. The same happens. We are on holiday and we can have a Skype connection with a member of our family or with a colleague, no matter where we are in the world. This is the simplest way to explain to you what a cloud service is. Microsoft's cloud is Microsoft Azure, which is the difference between sharing all the sky all together, or ceiling. This is a very important aspect for those who deal with manufacturing, innovative manufacturing activities in Italy. The examples I gave you can be found on the internet. There are smart cutting machines, smart bins, smart coffee machines, smart desks. What is a smart desk? It's a desk. Well, I sit at my desk. It may be a modern office. So I can sit at a desk one day, and then we have shared desks. I place my smartphone on the desk. It is fed. And when I say that I want to turn off a light, the light above my head will be turned off. It seems trivial, but this provides for the smartphone communication between the desk and the building. A smart desk, the fact of giving a command right in the moment and in the place where I need it. So everything works for us when all the innovation is transparent. Otherwise, it is a sort of a chimera. So let's talk about this dissemination of these technologies. Electronics is self-feeding. This is a label that is used today on over 5 million bottles of Italian wine. So it costs less than 20 cents. If I have my smartphone close to this label, this is a smart label, the application on the smartphone can tell me whether the wine is authentic, genuine or not. Think about the denomination of protected origin. This is just an example. With the right costs, it is possible to protect one of our national assets. A batch of wine, of Italian wine, deserves this kind of smart technology. So who purchases a bottle of Italian wine in America or in China can have the assurance as if he or she had a stamp of the state monopoly, that that kind of Italian wine is genuinely Italian. The costs of this label were higher in the past, but it now costs only less than 20 cents. And so we can finally start to protect, to really protect the Italian wine. This is a tangible innovation. This is the most important aspect. And then there's another aspect I would like to share with you. It's a reality I've been seeing for the past 2 years now. This label was produced by a startup made up by five people. In Italy, we have ideas, and we also have the possibility to make these ideas something which is alive. A multinational company such as STMicroelectronics make it possible to have affordable objects, and then multinational companies such as Microsoft make it possible for everybody to work on this data wherever you are in the world. And this leads to the reduction of costs for Italian companies to carry out innovation at low cost. And I notice that there are more and more startups, more and more companies, small and medium-sized enterprises in Italy, working on innovation because the barriers when it comes to costs have been reduced significantly thanks to the investments made by multinational companies such as STMicroelectronics and Microsoft. A company such as Headquarters in Bologna, with 22 employees, was bought by Microsoft Corporation. So the fact that large multinational companies admit that there is a great degree of innovation in Italy, I think is the best confirmation of the fact of Microsoft Corporation decided to purchase a very small company with 22 employees. This is the end of my contribution. I now leave the floor to my colleague. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'd like to start with Gianni Savio, leave the floor to Gianni Savio. He's going to tell us about his vision on smart cities, and he's going to show us what's taking place where he works. First of all, thank you. Thank you very much. Ours is a small group, so we are not as big as the companies whose representatives are sitting at this table, but it's important to have visibility. This project we're working on has been active for 1.5 years now, and I'd like to briefly show you this video, which briefly summarizes the concept at the very basis of our project. And after the first 3 minutes of the video, there is a minute of a drone flight illustrating the site. 2% of the planet is urban areas. They consume 75% of energy, and they emit 80% of carbon monoxide. In 1950, cities and towns covered about hosted about 30% of the world population. Now, 50%. In 2040, 75% of the world population will live in cities and towns. Every day on the Earth, there are 220,000 people more. So social housing is an answer to this emergency. Every week, 250,000 houses are built. In other words, one new city of 1 million inhabitants. Social housing concerns 10 million houses every year in developing countries. In this market, which is $240 billion worth, building policies are not smart at all. They are serial, repetitive, and they are based on basic infrastructures. This development model is not sustainable. Planet has a revolutionary solution. Its aim is to change the way in which social housing are built, based on smart criteria at the same costs. Smart means innovative, so new models of energy consumption, new ways of accessing information, and new social digital networks. A smart city consumes less, pollutes less, and costs less. The first smart city for social housing is currently being built in São Gonçalo do Amarante in Brazil, 55 kilometers from Fortaleza. This is a smart city for about 20,000 inhabitants, and it's based on four main pillars: architecture, the environment, technology, and social inclusion. Here you see some of the basic concepts that we would like to introduce in our smart city concept. These concepts range from architecture, we use some kind of a hierarchy in kind of roads use, recovery of rainwater, wastewater, mobility, smart mobility, sharing, waste collection, then monitoring of air and water quality, digital infrastructures, they are at the basis of everything, then a smart grid, cameras and sensors for safety purposes, then interactivity, smart public lighting, sharing economy, so creating social networks with which one can exchange goods and services. And then also spaces. This is possible thanks to Planet Up. That's the smart control panel of the smart city. In the future, the choice of a city or of a neighborhood that consumes less, pollutes less, and where living is less will be more important than the choice of the house itself. Planet has a vision, a more sustainable planet at an economic, ecological, and social level. Our vision has to become a mission. So planning and designing smart cities and neighborhoods in order to change a way to build social housing in the world. Of course, we're also doing some kind of publicity for us. So this is the video of the building site. This is the entrance to the town, to the city. We are currently building the central alley of the city. You see some people who are already coming to choose their house, the house they want to buy. Here we see some sample houses. One of the things we said before compared to social housing is that we wanted to break with this kind of serial kind of building. We have here a functional mix. There is an industrial area, a residential area, and a commercial area in the city. And we're currently building the infrastructures, you see it here. This is an installation for the collection of rainwater. And now this is more for presentation. We would like to understand why we focused on social housing so much, and especially in developing countries. So Planet's idea is that we have only one planet and it should be more sustainable at an environmental, ecological and economic level. And I think this idea is shared by many people. Planet carries out some actions to reach this goal, and its main objective is to build and design smart cities and neighborhoods for social housing. In other words, the idea is to combine all the concepts we've heard so far. Planet has understood that innovation, the real innovation in this sector, lies in the urban environment. It's not so much in the house, but rather outside the house. You can do lots of things in the house. Over the last few years, the focus was on domotics, but the real innovation comes from infrastructures and the services that you can find in your houses. The Industrial Revolution. So when you have a revolution like the Industrial Revolution is when you have a radical change with technological innovation that have a very rapid payback. So in factories we had the Industrial Revolution because in factories machinery was installed that could be paid back in relatively short period of time with great advantages. And the same applied with the IT Revolution. The same thing is taking place with the Digital Revolution in urban environments. We've heard before that all cities are currently considering changing their incandescent lamps to LED lamps because there's a very short payback time. So investment here is very advantageous, and this revolution can reach cities, finally reach cities. Three areas are worth mentioning. They are the areas we focus our research on. It's our work on smart cities. The innovations that are taking place concern three main areas. One is the optimization of energy consumption. So we should implement a whole series of trends and processes. We should change lighting on the streets. We should introduce smart meters to optimize household consumptions and so on. And that's referring all to energy. Second thing, the communication between Internet of Things and people. If I live in a smart city, I can receive a whole series of information helping me to optimize the way I use my city. For example, when it comes to parking, or when it comes to the choice of the correct route. In other words, this is cost and time optimization. Third area, the sharing economy or collaborative economy. In other words, we exchange information between individuals. And thanks to that, you can obtain goods and services at very interesting prices or which are easier to use. Ours is a city model which is focused on social housing. So our objective is therefore to show that a smart city consumes less, pollutes less, and costs less. That is because we should always develop development projects that are more sustainable, that are increasingly sustainable. The development we've seen, this kind of development we've seen is very important, so we need to find this kind of sustainable models. Then we should set up a smart house, and why should we do that? Why targeted to social housing? There's lots of data that support this. And one is this: 27% of the world population of at least 16 years of age. So we're talking about people who are going to become of age over the next few years, and they will buy houses. They will need to find a shelter. And this piece of information is a piece of data that we always convey, because it's important to find sustainable models of development. If we take a picture of the Earth now and you look at urban areas, and if you took a picture of our Earth in 2050, in 2050 over 60% has not been built. So over the next 35 years, houses are going to be built, infrastructures are going to be built exactly as happened over the last 400 years on the Earth, so at a much faster pace. So cities cover a large percentage of the Earth, and cities consume about 75% of the energy, and they emit 80% of carbon monoxide. So when we talk about sustainability models, one should definitely focus on cities. This data concerns houses alone. Every year, about 20 million houses are built in the world, 18 million millions in developing countries, and about half of them are social housing. So houses for people with lower incomes. And there's actually 250 houses, more or less, every week. Social housing today is built like that, as you can see in the slide. This is Brazil. That's a market of $240 billion. The data actually refers not so much to Brazil, but to the whole world. And social housing means giving good housing to people who have urgent needs. This data refers to China. This is no Photoshop. This is a real picture. This is Mexico. And Brazil again. So based on this, our idea was the following. Of course, we're talking about houses whose price depends on the social housing government plan. So houses of about 60 square meters and costing about $30 million. So we, starting from this data, we thought that we could put forward a model based on which, if we build 4,000 or 5,000 houses, that can be done differently. So that's why we set up our company in Turin. This is a smart engineering company, that's Planet Idea. They set up a research center and work in four environments: architecture, the environment, social inclusion. So the research and best practices that are most innovative in the world, and we try to integrate them, to introduce them in this project, which is a private project. This is something that I would like to point out, because it would, many people are tempted to say and to think that this is a publicly funded project. In fact, this is not the case. It is a private project. It is funded by private entrepreneurs to build a small city for 25,000 people. We sell both houses and lots of land. 20 million euros have been invested in the project so far. We set up a factory, because we're going to do anything on the spot. So, for example, all the houses are going to be built with a special type of cement that does not that helps rain to be drained out more easily. There are 90 people working in the site, and 30 kilometers of electrical. There are important major partners involved in the project. So we have Enel as a partner that owns the company distributing electricity in that part of Brazil. Then we have TIM, Ericsson, who's interested in the project. We are already currently working with Ericsson, with Arup, and a lot of other minor companies collaborating with us, because as we said before, our aim is to collect the ideas of everybody. For us, it's fundamental that these smart cities projects are open source. They have to be open, otherwise they are bound to fail. And no company in the world currently has all the technologies that are needed to build a smart city. So architecture, a smart city has to have the things that we normally take for granted, so, but which are not granted at all. So there should be a hierarchy in the use of roads, so that, for example, if you have you have equal access to go to work, for example, even if you live far away in the suburbs of the smart city, then the presence of greenery or best practices in the management of the building site, the use of proper technology, we may range from free Wi-Fi to parking sensors. For example, it's important to have spots where you can have free Wi-Fi, then smart lighting, smart nets, smart grids, and projects linked to smart urban safety. So, for example, together with Tyco, with the American company Tyco, we are currently working on a project that contemplates the presence of cameras on the streets or columns where you can warn the police if you've had a problem, and at the same time, not only the police, but also the inhabitants. And all the inhabitants can have a hub that becomes a real control panel for the city. So these are all concepts also linked to the environment, so recovery of white waters, of wastewaters, smart mobility, and last but not least, these concepts can then lead to a socially inclusive society. So there will be projects ranging from the common urban garden, book crossing, then an app where all citizens can place and post their ads, for example, looking for a job, and also creating some kind of a local economy. I'll move on to these slides very rapidly. Our aim is to build a smartness index so that everybody can have a protocol and can, if they want, start from, if they want, they can build a smart city and have a protocol, a smartness index, to check what actions are needed to do that, and maybe even be certified to then reuse that panel with its citizens. Thank you.
Come abbiamo visto.
So as we saw, I will now leave the floor to a local councillor, Mr. Parolini, with competencies for economic development of the Lombardy region. So the as we saw, thanks to the work of these companies, it is possible to carry out initiatives such as the one described by Gianni Savio. And these initiatives have an impact which is different from the one we saw when looking at the pictures of Brazil, China, and Mexico. Another topic re-emerges, that of resources. So the contribution of a public entity is fundamental, because in many instances it is better to start from scratch rather than making pre-existing areas smart. This is another issue I'm presenting for local councillors' comments. Thank you very much. The previous speakers have provided you with a technical framework which is very clear. We know the state of the art. We know that the basic components are advanced. We know that there are enormous potentials, and luckily we have lots of companies in Italy who are able to produce them and to innovate. And they also have the capability to recognize where it is possible to make progresses. We know that there are Italian managers of multinational companies who are keen to observe the Italian reality, and we've learned that the multi-utilities, most of all those of the Lombardy region, have a long tradition and are capable of using new technologies to provide an answer to the needs. What we saw, however, is a framework of a lot of potentials, which in many instances have not been expressed yet. I believe that over the next few years, many of these possibilities, of these potentials, will be fully exploited. There are some limits in what we've listened to. First of all, the limit of expressing, the fact of expressing potentials in a general framework which is still not ready to make several evaluations. A2A has used these technologies to make its productive system more efficient, so it spends less for its activities. The immediate repercussion is that the citizens have a benefit because they do not see full garbage bins, services are used better, and some functions are more easier to use and more and they get cheaper. So in this case, the supply chain works perfectly, but there are some limits when it comes to the integration, and because we see many sectoral interventions which are very efficient, but there is a little degree of communication between the sectors, between one function and the other, little communication, still little communication with the final users, and substantially we see the lack of capability, and I'm talking about the situation, a general situation, so that each service is integrated in the in what is with what is being provided in other sectors and in other territories. I will simply give you one example. In our cities, in our region, we have lots of Wi-Fi hotspots. I've been working for months now, obtaining some results in Bergamo and Brescia, but not only in these cities, so that there is one single access point and one single account for all those who live in Lombardy. Because at present, each time I move from one town to another, I need to have another account. This may be obvious, but it's not so obvious. And it's probably not so obvious because we have a problem with the vision, not only because of technical problems. So this is the first task of politics, that of identifying the aims, the objectives. We are providing tools to make life easier, to consume energies better, to spend less, to do the same things, and to do these things better and with less efforts. So the fact of going to a tourist town and being able to find a parking place in 5 minutes instead of 30 minutes means that we will pollute less, we will enjoy our vacation more than we are doing now. We've heard that you're working on it, but it's not yet a reality. However, there is a fact. If the provision of services focuses on the final users only, it probably responds to individual needs. Instead, we need to rethink about the meaning of city. This meaning, well, the cities have enlarged. We have 1,500 municipalities in Lombardy now. They are all autonomous. 80% of these municipalities form part of a widespread city. Places which are integrated, because we have an integrated social life, an integrated economic life, and because we have an integrated way to live and move. So we need to understand more the extent to which these services can respond to the needs of a community, which is not simply a local community, but which is a community located in a physical space. In history, towns and cities were born, were created, and then they enlarged because they represented, first of all, the recognition of a community having certain needs, and they represented the identification of a way to answer those needs, which created an identity vision. So if we do not respond to these needs, we may produce efficient tools, improving the lives of the citizens, but which do not respond to the common needs, namely that of helping our lives in our relations with the others. So I believe that the key topic of this year's meeting focuses on the key topic, the view of the other people as a good for us. This must not be an abstract kind of vision. It has to be something which affects the way in which we develop technologies and the way in which we propose them. Everything needs a vision. If this is not the case, at the end, we will certainly lose control of the technological development of our cities. And I don't think this is a prospect we wish. And this is one of the tasks of culture, but also a fundamental task of politics, of decision makers, who need to create visions and to provide with aims. I would also like to talk a little bit about what we're doing as a Lombardy region. First of all, in my own activity, we have a total, an overall view, vision of the region as an individual, widespread community with the same aims and the same identity. This community needs tools to make these relationships effective. This means that despite the forecasts on a virtual life, the displacement of people and goods has remained a key factor. So Internet of Things means that things remain at the core of our everyday lives. And the body interacts with the things. So we recover in the digital world, which is less virtual than we expected, we recover the role of physical elements, which means practically a system of mobility which enables everybody to go from one place to another as rapidly as possible and spending as little money as possible. And this, having a smart city, means having an integrated mobility, enabling everybody to move from one place to another in an affordable way and as rapidly as possible. Then there is another issue, that of accessibility of information. I try from time to time to make a search on Google. The more complex the research, the less data I get. So we need to have an access to data in an ordered way and in a smart way. I believe that there is still a lot to do in this respect, and the region is working, the regional authorities are working for this to happen. I think that something has already being made, and the most advanced sector is that of healthcare, but there are other sectors such as culture and economics which are equally important. So we are implementing several measures with the aim of integration. It's almost an obsession to us. I will give you another example. I also deal with the tourist sector. The Lombardy region is one of the first, one of the four regions of Italy when it comes to tourism. We have lots of resources, lots of cultural sites, a lot of historic sites, but we have lots of difficulties in creating a network of all these initiatives and all the resources when it comes to tourism. This is our password. We need to integrate initiatives and we need to carry out an activity of promotion when it comes to the offer of tourist services, and this needs the tools that were described earlier. Either you are a provider of data in real time, or you support decisions that have to be more and more corresponding to a logic of development, as I said earlier. We are launching some initiatives when it comes to startups, and I am glad that the representative of Microsoft recognized the value and the importance of lots of startups in Italy, and entrepreneurs need to be assisted in this respect. I'm glad to hear that we still need to have new buildings built. We will call all the stakeholders involved on to work on smart living, the creation of a new concept of household and the new concept of supply chain in the sector of house building. The previous speaker was particularly interesting to me. The idea of thinking about a new kind of city as a smart city, I think, is an initiative which looks towards the future, but which also rises to the occasion. We will not build new towns or new cities in Italy or in Lombardy in the next few years. Our problem is that of changing the towns and the cities we're living in, how to change the households, how to change the buildings and the houses we live in. Hopefully, this initiative provides us with some examples of how it is possible to change our towns without changing their identity, or having our towns and cities go back to be more human being-centered, because sustainability is a key topic. I will conclude my contribution by launching several proposals. So the key word is integration. This means giving the tools for those who move to look at other people in terms of sharing initiatives. I'm glad to see that this is already a way to go, a way of acting which has been implemented by the multinationals. Of course, the question, the issue of patents, of defending intellectual property is quite an important issue. Yet, the idea that you can grow only if you share what you've discovered is fundamental. Do you remember the invention of the Metamax, the most innovative way of reproducing videos? That was a Betamax. And it was it went bankrupt and it disappeared because it was not available for anybody. So a less efficient means, tool, which was shared, replaced the Betamax system. So we need tools. So these are the proposals. First of all, we are working to create an environment for the economic system, a realm in which it is possible to get credited, to establish a correct and friendly relationship with the public administration. This is not a conquest, it is a need. It is a compelling need. The Lombardy region is the only Italian region which is working to create an IT brochure, an IT register of all the businesses. So the register will have to be filled in, but we're creating it. We want to create an ambit, a realm in which you can be accredited, in which it is possible to look for partners and to look for technical solutions for the problems of the businesses, a place where it is easy to find what is needed by companies, including human competences, human skills. The second issue, this is easier, more simple, and maybe some of the people here can give us a hand, can lend us a hand. We need to have a single and individual Wi-Fi network for the entire Lombardy region, so that each time I reach a hotspot, I already have my account, which is the same wherever I go in Lombardy. The last issue is an initiative we're working on, namely identifying some municipalities in Lombardy to create the smart city on an existing town or city, possibly an ancient, possibly we can find several municipalities in Italy, so as to show how it is possible to create an integral smart city. So not bearing in mind individual needs or individual objectives, but a series of integrated services which correspond to a need, that of rebuilding in the territories, communities. This is a fundamental issue. These tools must be tools for the relationships between men. Otherwise, they are technologies that leave all the citizens alone, although they provide a response to individual needs. Thank you very much. Thank you very much to local councillor Parolini. I will conclude by saying that we may give a title, so from smart cities to smart vision, so smart region. So the region Lombardy is a good candidate for becoming the first smart region of Italy. I will conclude by a quotation by Mr. Bersanelli yesterday. Marco said, getting back to the topic of the title of the meeting, "You are good for me. technology translates this good in a utility. The level of this utility, usefulness, is equal to the level of the improvement it brings. This is why it is important to educate subjects, human beings, able to use all the good aspects of technologies without expecting what that technology cannot provide. So we've discussed for about 1 hour and a half today, and I think that some steps forward when it comes to this achievement, so the relationship between technology and the human aspects of technology, I think we provided a good contribution. The fundraising campaign of the meeting goes on. You can find in the various pavilions ways to provide your contribution. It is an enlarged crowdfunding because the meeting relies on sponsors, but most of all on the individual supporters. Thank you very much for your attention.